This is Merryn Jose and you're listening to Merlian Podcasts. Today we have with us Philip Solomon. Philip Solomon is a very famous spiritual medium who is also an author, writer and broadcaster, for many years operating for the BBC at their Pebble Mill studios in England. Today he has clients worldwide and his own radio program on WCR 101.8 FM, and he writes the back page feature column for Psychic News, the oldest established and most respected publication of its kind in the world. Philip always describes himself as just very ordinary, who just happens to have a very special gift. Welcome to Merlian Podcast, Philip.
Hi, Mary. How are you? That's just great.
Yeah, it's so nice to hear you, and it's a clear line today.
It's lovely to speak to you again.
Yes. Now, my first question, which is an obvious one because you're a psychic medium, when did you realise you were a psychic?
Well, you know, Merryn, I've been able to see spirit and talk to spirit since I was a very tiny little boy, really, about 2 years of age. But I think really aware of working as a medium, I would probably think quite early, you know, maybe about 10 or 11.
Really?
Mm.
And what kind of experiences did you have?
Well, I mean, I have to say, you know, I was born, really, to parents who were mediums, so I was brought up around the fields, you know.
Oh.
Yeah, but and my grandma too, and really, I remember having a conversation with a lady when I was ever so little, you know, and obviously a lady from the other side, and describing her to her in later life. Mother explained to me that this would be a lady who was known in the family as Great Grandmama.
Oh.
And, you know, it was all very natural to me, Merryn, really, being born into a family, you know, like yourself, really, where it was not unnatural, you know.
In fact, it was, for you and me, unnatural that people didn't understand what we saw.
It was, Merryn. I mean, when I went to school, I was quite surprised that the other kids couldn't see spirits.
Yes.
and little friends, you know, so...
That's right.
It's always with me, really, you know, I've never really... I mean, I've taken development classes for others, but I've never really sat in development myself because, you know, it was always there. And Mother being such a well-known medium, you know, I think all these things were sort of explained to me, matter of fact, and just developed as we went along, you know.
I see. So your mother was a professional medium?
Oh, indeed, yeah. Mom was probably... I mean, Mother was the president, you know, of the West Midlands Spiritualist Church, but she was one of the best mediums in the country, really. Mother would have... I mean, my dad's a good medium too, still alive, Dad, but...
Yes.
I mean, Mom was friends with people like Doris Collins and Doris Stokes and people like that. Oh, she was a great medium, Mom, yeah.
Oh, my goodness, I didn't know that.
No, she was, yeah.
When she passed, Philip, did you have communication with her?
You know, everyone asks me that, and I have to say to you, Merryn, in all honesty, no, because Mother had always said to me when she'd passed this way, she'd done her work in this world, unless it was something absolutely desperately important, she didn't have any intentions of coming back, and she hasn't as yet.
You know, that makes sense to me.
Well, it doesn't to many, you know. I'm so pleased that you said that, because you try and explain this to so many and they don't. When you're the son of a famous medium,
yes,
they assume that the work will be there between you, but never, not as yet.
No, I had a lot of dreams about my mother, but I was kind of expecting her to stand at the bottom of the bed in a glowing white light, which she never did. So
well,
I understand that.
That is how it is sometimes, but it wasn't for me, and hasn't been the case.
No. You give psychic development classes, don't you? You teach
yes,
them?
Yes, I teach and develop other mediums, you know, right from sort of young people just starting out, really, to working with quite developed mediums who perhaps want to just tighten their focus a little bit or, you know, be a little bit more at one with their own work, you know?
Yes. And we have a friend in common, Hans Holzer.
Oh, and one of my dearest friends, Hans Holzer. I love him to pieces. Very instrumental in me coming out to work in New York and America. And we wrote a book together, of course.
Yes, you did. And it's Beyond Death, Conditions in the Afterlife.
That's right.
Tell us a little bit about the book for our listeners.
Well, it's an unusual book, really. I've never been one of the sort of mediums for writing about sort of connections with celebrities and all that sort of thing. But we did have a lot of celebrities who came through. It was a collection of communications from the other side and an overview, really, of what the spirit world is really like. Many ordinary people came through and many famous people. And it did very, very well in America, really. I remember coming on, you would know better than me, really, but I came in a guy called Joe Franklin's show.
Oh, yes,
And he was just lovely, a wonderful man, and he knew many of these celebrities which had come through for the book, you know, and he was fascinated by it. But, I mean, the thing with Holzer, really, Hans, love him to pieces, but, you know, he went and checked whatever I got to make sure as it was completely accurate
wherever he could. That's good.
A special book, really. I think a parapsychologist and a medium working together, a very special book and one that I'm very proud of.
So how did you meet Hans?
Well, I'd read a feature that he'd written in a magazine called Fate magazine.
Oh, yes, I know.
About American psychics and various mediums and whatnot. And it was quite cutting in some areas, but I agreed with everything that he said. And I wrote to him and said this. And had a letter back from Hans saying, well, would you like to get in touch and have a word with me and we'll have a chat, which I did. And you know what Hans is like. I ended up doing a reading for him.
Yes.
And, I don't want to blow my own trumpet, but I think he was very impressed.
I'll blow it for you. He was very, very impressed and said you
were
one of the best mediums that he'd worked with.
Yes, he has described me as the best medium in the world, and one or two others over here as well. But you know, Merryn, you understand this better than most. I'm just an ordinary guy with a special gift, and we're only ever as good as our last message. So
absolutely.
It's nice and it's wonderful. But a special man to me in my life, Hans. Yeah.
Yes, he is, and his daughter Alexandra. She's just writing a book called Growing Up Haunted.
Reviewed it. I think it's fascinating.
Isn't it?
I think it's a great book.
It's a wonderful book. Yes.
I really enjoyed it. I did a little review for it for the publishers, you know, and I'm very impressed with it. You know, I haven't actually met Alexandria. I met Nadine, his other daughter, but I haven't met her yet in person. But she seems a very talented girl with a lot of natural ability.
Yes.
I suppose psychically and as a writer.
Oh, yes, she's got it all. She's carrying
sure.
on the family line. I wanted to ask you, because of the book and because of bringing in all these well-known people, is that how you became a psychic to the stars or a medium to the stars?
Not really, to be quite honest with you. You know, I used to be very involved in sort of rock and roll in England, you know, and knew sort of most of the people, like the Rolling Stones and the Beatles and the Searchers. I mean, people of the 60s will remember these names, you know, and Tom Jones and people like that. And, you know, most of these people, Led Zeppelin, really knew these people already through rock and roll. But a lot of those people, you know, many years ago, not before that, maybe the time of sort of, I suppose, I don't know if you remember Billy Fury and these sort of people.
Oh, yes, I do. I was there at the concert.
Of course you were. Well, and Lee Everett, Kenny Everett's girlfriend. I mean, they used to come and see Mother, you know.
Okay.
I already sort of knew them, and I mean, that's a title that another sort of TV person gave me over the psychic to the stars. But they're just the same as anyone else, aren't
sure.
they? They lose someone and the loss is difficult and you try to help.
That's right. But I do understand you had tea with the Queen of England. Now, can you tell us about how that came about? Not many people can say that.
That was a lovely day, really. You know, I do a lot of work for charity, really, and I don't know how to put this, but a lot of the members of the royal family, I think, of from Queen Victoria down to the present lot, really, have always had an interest in spiritualism, allegedly. But, you know, I mean, I think they knew of my work, and because of a lot of what I've done, I was invited, to meet the Queen and be presented at Buckingham Palace. And, it was a wonderful day in my life, something that I'll always remember. And
that's wonderful.
Yeah, it was splendid, really.
And tell us about your charities, then.
One of the charities that are particularly close to my heart is anything to do with the visually impaired. We have various institutes for the visually impaired and blind people in England, you know, and that's something that I've supported over the years. I actually started, again, you talk of, I suppose, the rich and famous. I don't like to use that term, but I mean, you, of course, you will remember the Shadows and Hank Morvin, very famous guitar player.
Sure.
I got him to donate one of his electric guitars, which raised about £5,000 for the Institute of the Blind Institute, you know. And
fantastic.
People like Elton John and even Tony Blair donated something, you know.
Oh, wonderful.
And, I have a great belief in helping those sort of people. I think whatever you do in this world, you reap what you sow.
Yes.
And, you know, it's a charity that's close to my heart. I'm very interested in anything to do with heart operation condition charities as well, but probably the one that's most... probably closest to me, I think, would be the visually impaired, really.
That's wonderful.
Thank you.
Now, I'm going to go back a little bit about the ghosts. Can you share a real ghost story with us?
Yeah, I mean, it was a funny thing, really, when I first started to write ghost books, you know, Merryn. Mother being the president of Dawlish and Spiritualist Church, which is the regional area for the West Midlands, you know, people would always be coming along with ghost stories, you know, and looking for Mother to explain them. And I often ended up with the job of going out and investigating them, and it was fascinating. One that I always remember was really unusual, where there was a gentleman who kept, again, like Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth, he kept pigeons, you know, and he passed to the other side, and a young couple had taken on the property. And the young lass there kept seeing, like, a black and white shed that pigeons were kept. They used to keep pigeons in many years ago, you know.
Mm.
And no one would believe it, but I went down there and saw, well, only what you could describe as hundreds of pigeons in the garden, and they weren't of this world.
My gosh.
You know, it's a bit like Alfred Hitchcock's The Bird, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, they didn't hurt anyone, Merryn. They were just... ghosts. A fascinating one, that was.
Yeah, because a lot of people say that animals don't have souls. Well, we know they do.
Oh, of course they do. And, of course they do.
And you must see them then, that they hang around their owners. I was talking to an animal psychic, Susan Derren, and she was saying...
Oh, yes.
She said, absolutely, they...
Of course they do. Your pets are there for you. The spirit world is whatever you want it to be, but your pets and your animals, they're all there for you. The collective energy of the pets that you've had over the years is there for you. Of course it is. You know, I often say to people, you know, don't worry about when you lose a pet. You've not lost that pet. You've just got to wait, maybe, until it's your time to pass to the other side, and they'll be there with you, you know.
That's right. Now, you've also worked in the film industry, haven't you, with the BBC?
Yeah, I have a BA honours in TV and film production, yeah. I've made quite a few videos and different films and whatnot, you know. I mean, I used to work for the BBC at the Pebble Mill Studios in TV, and, you know, working as the resident psychic there at Pebble Mill.
Oh.
And there were film opportunities. I always used to end up in front of the camera, but more recently, you know, Merryn, to be honest with you, I've had a fascination with behind the camera, and I have ambitions as a director. I think that's something for the future, but it's something that I'm very keen to do.
And would this be with the kind of psychic theme?
Oh, yes. Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. I mean, I'm very keen to make those sort of programmes, but much more serious than what we've seen on British or American TV, if I'm absolutely honest with you, really.
Yes.
I'm looking to make something a lot more... I don't know, real and a true presentation of what the paranormal can be turned into.
Yes.
And to me, that's the normal.
What about your book being made into a film?
Well, yes, that is a rumour at the moment. I've just finished writing my autobiography, Guided by the Light, the autobiography of a born medium.
Right.
And as you probably know, we've mentioned a couple of people who are very good friends of mine over in the States.
Mm.
And there is some interest in it being made into a film. The only thing that I said to the original pitch was, well, it's too much. You know, my life's very much like that kid in The Sixth Sense.
Yes.
But there again, I mean, it would be different. There are different things. And it could happen, Merryn. It's in the early days, really. We have to see the popularity of the book.
Yes.
The initial, the publisher are Apex Publishing, which you can see on their website if you want to have a quick look at it.
Mm.
But it looks very promising, and it does look as though there might be a film link into it. But at this stage, I couldn't say that for sure.
I know people are very hungry for all this kind of information.
They are. I mean, and having my experience now in sort of making films, I mean, I suppose, you know, if there was an opportunity, I would like to direct my own story.
Yes, that would be good.
Yeah.
And you really seem to have a handle on the media business. I understand you also have a radio show in London, or in England, sorry, not in London.
Central England, yeah.
Yes.
Wolverhampton, Central England, yeah. WCR 101.8 FM.
Okay.
It's a 50s and 60s show. Actually, my guest this week, you may have heard of him, a gentleman called Derek Akura, who's been on many sort of the Living TV programmes. Very, very well known over here. He's the sort of, I suppose, the major equivalent of somebody like John Edward in the States.
Oh, OK. And he's obviously up and coming.
Oh, he's a very, very top guy. He's one of the, you know, respected as one of the best mediums in the country.
Oh, that's very interesting.
I think he's on TV about four nights a week.
Really?
Massively popular.
Now, Philip, for my last question, what is your vision for the future? What do you see?
I have an ambition to turn the paranormal into the normal, because there are answers
yes.
to almost everything that we don't understand. It's just approaching it and studying it in a sensible way. I just want to turn the paranormal into the normal. I'm a spiritualist by religion. Our religion is based, our way of life is based in proving that there is no death, that life goes on forever. And that is my main task in life, whether it's an A1 celebrity or just a person in the street. They need the proof of a continuing life, and it is the truth.
Yes. So thank you very much for joining us today, Philip. And can you, for our listeners, give your website?
I can. It's www.philipsolomon.pwp.blueyonder.co.uk.
Oh, thank you, Philip. This has been a very interesting interview.
Great to speak to you again, Merryn.
You too. We'll be in touch.
I hope so.
This is Merryn Jose, and thank you for listening to